across Wisconsin from Civic Media. This is Up North News Radio. Now, live from our Lake Wissota studio, here's the founding editor of Up North News, Pat Brightlow.
All right, coffee cup has been refilled, ready for another hour here on Up North News Radio on this Wednesday, March 20th, 2024. Nice to have you along. Meteorologist Brittany Merlot has our forecast in just a sec. First to tell you, coming up this hour, we will again in this week's homeroom segment remind folks that the reason there are 91 school referendums on the ballot around the state on April 2nd, it's no accident. And it's not that 91 school districts suddenly decided to become very wasteful with their spending. We're going to talk about the legislature's role in chronic underfunding of public education, kicking the can to property taxpayers. And yet property taxpayers, you know, should not take that out on the school district. Think about your legislative elections come November. We're going to talk to two members of the Chippewa Falls School District about the referendum here in Chippewa Falls and all around the state coming up in just a moment. Also, we should we'll do our little contest here right away, our Ride into Spring contest. And to do that, you're going to need the Civic Media app. So if you haven't done it yet, download the Civic Media app. And then you look up any one of the Civic Media radio stations, preferably the one in your area, if you have one in your area. And by the way, go to civicmedia.us if you want to know more about that. But anyway, use the text feature and text a keyword, and you'll be entered in this hour's contest for the Ride into Spring drawing. And the keyword is pool, as in swimming pool, P-O-O-L, text pool, through the Civic Media app to one of the Civic Media stations, and you will automatically be entered. There is four winners each day, 7 a.m., 10 a.m., 1 p.m., 3 p.m. They'll draw those four daily winners, and they win an overnight getaway to Chula Vista Resort in Wisconsin Dells, and then also entered for several grand prizes that will be taken care of at the end of the contest. So again, pool, P-O-O-L, text that through the Civic Media app, and you will be entered in the Civic Media statewide Ride into Spring text contest. All right, coming up on 7:09 now, meteorologist Brittany Merlot is here to tell us that, I'll tell you, it looks better than it feels out there right now. It looks very pretty. It doesn't feel so good.
That is the perfect way to put it, honestly. You head outside, temperatures are in the teens up north to the 20s, down to the south, but with those winds still whipping up to 30 miles per hour, it is feeling like the single digits in the northern half of the state.
Yes, Rob is telling us in Tigerton, it's cloudy 23, the wind chill 11. I don't want 11, but no. I got a feeling.
Pat, it goes up to 11. Yet.
Yes.
Yes. Oh, man, we are stuck in that cold here today. In fact, the winds aren't going to let up, and our highs today are only going to feel like the 20s statewide. That's what you need to dress for today. Don't worry about what the actual forecast is. Just know that it's going to be feeling like the 20s all day, but it's going to be bright and beautiful, ton of sunshine. And then we have to prep, of course, for the one of four major snowstorms that are headed our way to close out this month.
I'm sorry. What?
Yep. Just throw that on you.
Pat, can I cut her mic?
No, apparently this is like life or death stuff. We need to let her talk. So did you say one of four snowstorms coming this way?
Yes, I did. So one of four before we get into April. Actually, as we go into April, we'll have one hitting us, and I'm counting that as the fourth one. So a very, very active winter weather pattern headed our way, and the first accumulating snow Thursday night into Friday afternoon. Yeah. You're scratching your head.
It's me. I'm the problem. It's me. I put a fuel stabilizer in the snowblower over the weekend. And
you did?
Yeah. We're done. We're done. Yep. It's all set.
You jinxed it.
Yeah. It's all me. All right. Thank you, Brittany. We'll keep an eye on all this.
Yeah, thanks, Brittany.
Yeah, no problem. Cheers to all the winter weather enthusiasts out there.
Yes. Enjoy your day or two before it melts each time. So there.
Thank you.
Temperatures around Civic Media look like this. It's 20 here on Lake Wissota, 14. All the temperatures around the state are down 1 to 3 degrees from the last hour. Hayward's down to 14, Park Falls 17, Wausau 22 degrees right now. Green Bay and La Crosse reporting 24 degrees. Wisconsin Rapids 21. Oshkosh 27, 27 as well in Madison and in Waukesha. And you get the forecast throughout the day here on the Civic Media Radio Network. In our daily newsletter that you can sign up for at Up North News, go to upnorthnewswi.com and click on newsletter in the top banner and become a subscriber. And you get all kinds of great little bits of information. And one of there's two from this morning's newsletter that I wanted to pass along that you'd be reading otherwise. The first is a story about Margaret Danhauser Brown. She was not only an inaugural member of the Racine Belles, but she was the only player with a listed hometown in Wisconsin. Now, of course, if you know anything about the 1992 movie A League of Their Own with Gina Davis, Madonna, Rosie O'Donnell, you know that the Racine Belles were part of the All-American Girls Baseball League that played eight seasons from 1943 to 1950, winning the league's first championship title and then two others. But again, there was one member who had a tie into Wisconsin, and you can read more in the newsletter about her playing prowess and other achievements that she made by checking out that story in the Up North News Daily Newsletter. Also, Christina Lori puts in a reminder there, Greg, that I had completely forgotten. We knew that Top Chef was being filmed all around Wisconsin spots a few months back.
Yeah.
The premiere is tonight.
Oh! Lordy.
Oh, yes, sir. So set your DVR for Bravo and stay tuned for Top Chef Wisconsin kicking off a 14-week national publicity campaign for the nice. State's food scene.
There you go. Mm-hmm. I can't wait to not be able to get into the restaurants I love now.
Yeah, I am not a regular watcher of that, but I'm really glad that she got that note there because I'm definitely going to DVR that because yes. Now it's my new favorite 14-week soap opera as we follow the perils and pitfalls of
yes.
people looking to be the top.
I just want to make the best food ever. Okay, that's great. Yeah, why are you crying?
Okay, who I was looking at the text line here. Luke Mathers literally just texted a GIF right now of somebody being very excited about Top Chef.
Or maybe he's just matters. Excited That's, that we're talking.
I think he forgot the keyword what it is. And you can't win anyway, Mathers, so don't be texting that.
No, it's his reaction to Top Chef. I mean, this is nothing against Luke, and I love you, Luke. I think you're handsome and capable. But he strikes me as the type of fella who is loving Top Chef. He loves that show. Just
oh yeah.
Because he's a foodie guy. He loves the food.
All right, well, let's see if it's tonight, and then Luke is on with us every Thursday, so I think every Thursday is just going to be Luke Mathers breaking down the last night's episode of Top Chef.
Well, then what I'll be saying is, Luke, I know I watched it, but why don't you explain for everybody else what happened?
I like how you're having an imaginary one-sided fight with somebody who's not here right now.
Luke fights with me all the time.
Well, because he can. Because again, he's very
boss.
Handsome and capable, and yeah, could leave you out on the street on a heartbeat notice. Yeah. All right. There will be even more electric vehicle charging stations popping up around Wisconsin after Governor Evers signed two bills to bolster the state's EV, electric vehicle infrastructure. It allows the Department of Transportation to receive and administer some $78 million in federal funds. One of them changes current law to allow businesses to offer EV chargers that sell electricity by the kilowatt hour, which can incentivize more businesses to start offering EV charging. And it also requires the state to receive funding through part of the bipartisan infrastructure law to pay for all of this. It's all designed to support the construction of fast public EV charging stations along major driving corridors that allow EVs to recharge in less than an hour. And then there's another bill that allows more funds to come in to, again, support the businesses that want to put in EV charging stations. I would like one of those someday when the time is right, and I'm glad that many people are catching on with electric vehicles. I've got... we recently bought a hybrid Not the kind that you plug in, but the kind that charges itself. And I really enjoy it. I mean, it's a game changer, Greg. But down by you, that's a corridor where you can definitely see where you'd have a whole lot of charging stations. Here up north, it's a bit of a tougher sell for now. But as that network grows, then maybe we'll see some more EVs out there.
Oh, absolutely. I have a hybrid as well. I've been driving one since 2013. I absolutely love it. It's a Honda. It's never going to die. And like I'm thinking of a new choice for a car, I was thinking hybrid or EV. And one of the things I do take in consideration is, you know, the technology isn't brand new, but it's also like, you know, I'm sure even
still
in
developing.
5 years it'll be better. But those charging stations up north, out in the country, out in the desert, you know, mm-hmm. you have to have an app to be able to find them. And I'm terrified of being a quarter tank of gas.
Yes, right.
If my car has like 14% of electricity, I'm like, I'm just going to live here. I live in this desert now.
Well, I have a daughter that lives in Idaho, up in the mountains.
Oh,
there.
That's so cool.
And as more people are moving to that area around Yellowstone and Jackson Hole and places like that, she's noticing all kinds of Teslas and other EVs sale, because people really use them a lot when they lived on the West Coast. But as they're moving out of California or Oregon and heading, you know, to Idaho or Wyoming or points like that, they're realizing the infrastructure isn't really quite there yet to be charging things.
Yeah.
Charging cars.
That makes sense.
So, like, I mean, again, it'll come. And I'm looking forward to that because, like I said, my next car, I've had nothing but Jeep Wranglers. And I love them. But my tushy's getting old now. And I need to park it in something soft and luxurious. So
I need that just to be... My tushy's getting old. I need soft and luxurious.
And now here's Pat Kreitlow. My tushy's getting old. Yeah. So it's going to be a, you know, like a Buick or a Cadillac or, you know, something like that.
A Lincoln Town Car.
Yes. There we go. Well, look, still my favorite car ever of all the old cars I had as a kid, basically a Mercury Cougar XR7, a 1978 blue, two-toned. Oh, that thing, it was an aircraft carrier, but it was a luxurious aircraft carrier.
It got a mile and a half to the gallon.
Uh-huh, and was leaking oil like crazy, so we finally had to get rid of it. But, boy, if I could get something like that again for my elderliness,
yeah,
I'm all good. I'm all good with that. We'll unpack more of the news coming up on Up North News Radio in just a bit. Just a reminder, wherever you're listening across Wisconsin, when you're here, you're up north live from Lake Wasota on the Civic Media Radio Network. Anniversary of the birth of Jerry Reed.
Well, now me and Homer Jones and Big John Pallet had a big crap game going back in the alley. And I kept rolling them.
If you're not familiar with When You're Hot, You're Hot, do yourself a favor. Download that fun little tune. All right, this in Getty Images has determined that a photograph of the late Queen Elizabeth was manipulated. The picture agency said the image was, quote, digitally enhanced at the source. According to the handout, Getty Images can confirm that in accordance with its editorial policy, it has placed an editor's note on a handout image stating that it has been digitally enhanced, the company confirmed to Fox television stations. The photo was shared on April 21st of last year and was taken by, Greg, that infamous digital photographer, Kate Middleton, the Princess of Wales. It's her again.
Oh.
Her. She... The worst Photoshopper ever, apparently.
And she's got money. It's not like she can just hand it to somebody like, here, make this look real.
Exactly. And but of course, I hate playing the conspiracy game, but how do we know that all the, they blame Kate for the last one? They blame Kate for this one. Nobody's seen Kate. There was some video that purported to show her the other day. I didn't think it looked like her. So I don't know. Is she being held hostage somewhere until she learns how to Photoshop the right way? You're not coming out until we stop getting kill notices from the AP and from Getty Images.
This lacks depth and character.
The photo that Kate posted on March 10th of an official Instagram account that she shares with her husband, Prince William, shows them seated outdoors, the royal family, smiling and surrounded by their three children. And I'm looking at it, and there's the queen sitting in the middle. Yeah, is that E.T. in the background? I'm not sure. I can't make out how she says it. The AP said they initially published the photo because it was issued by Kensington Palace, but later retracted it because on further inspection, it appeared the image had been manipulated, including, you know, the way that Princess Charlotte's left hand looked. And, you know, again, it's only leading to all the conspiracy theory talk. And again, I hate conspiracy theory talk, but when you give us no other choice, when you hide in your palace and you put out photos that, you know, look like a rank beginner manipulated, what else are we supposed to think about this? And I know the correct answer. Don't think about it. It's none of your business. I get it.
That's the question I ultimately have about this whole thing is, what consequence do we have, not just as Americans, but just as people in general, by not caring at all about this? Like, if she's in danger, then okay, fine. Then she needs to not be in danger. I hope, you know what I mean? Like, this feels mm-hmm. like, oh, I want to care, but I just don't.
No, I'm definitely not deeply invested in it, but I think it's just that journalistic curiosity.
Yeah.
That now here's a person in a prominent position, granted in another country, but yeah. still this person. And it's just like, we've never really seen anything like this. This is as close as we get to Capricorn One, which was the movie about how it was a big government conspiracy to stage man landing on the moon.
Yeah.
You know, there's just something there, and I'm not caught up in it, but I'm really curious. I can't wait to find out how this all ends. Or does it?
Wait, or does it?
Or does it? There we go.
If you had to listen to one person talk about something, would it rather be flat earth or faking the moon landing? You had to talk to one or the other.
Oh my gosh. I guess it would have to be the flat earth one. Why would you give me that kind of a choice? Yikes.
Because it's a terrible choice.
That's like, you know, who do you want to sit next to? Is it going to be Ted Cruz or, you know, is it going to be Ron Johnson? It's like, no, I don't.
Oh, I'd Ron Johnson. Absolutely. I just stare at him. I'd be like, you've done nothing.
Here's something people will care about.
Yes.
There's about to be a chocolate shortage. I should have had a sound effect there of just people screaming and running for the hills. But according to CNN, satisfying your sweet tooth is going to get more expensive. A recent report from Wells Fargo found that dwindling supply around the world is causing cocoa prices to skyrocket. And I got a feeling that, today is our climate check day. Part of the supply issue has to do with the climate, including tree diseases brought on by heavier rainfall. Cocoa tree farmers in West Africa are dealing with dry temperatures and extreme winds from this year's El Nino. The price of cocoa has more than doubled over the last year.
So therefore, we're having a chocolate shortage?
A chocolate shortage.
That's great.
Note here says I did not realize that Greg Bach had been made king for a day. No more chocolate being used with coconut. So we've now suddenly freed up a whole bunch of chocolate that can be used for everything else.
You know what, Pat? Maybe there is a God above us who smiles down and smiling down on me right now. Yes, fine. I believe. I do believe now.
Okay. Get some sports headlines at 7:26 here. We are only 8 days away from the Brewers opening day. I guess technically, the regular season for Major League Baseball opened this morning with the Dodgers and the Padres playing a game in South Korea. I think that game started about 2 hours ago. So, and those games will count in the standings. And so the regular season is underway, at least for those two teams. For the Brewers, it will be a week from tomorrow, March 28th. They will be in Queens, New York to take on the New York Mets. And then the home opener will be the following Tuesday, April 2nd, against the Minnesota Twins. But Spring training baseball goes on for the Brewers in Arizona. And if you are listening on WRCE Richland Center or in the area or are going to be in the area on Friday afternoon, you can catch a Brewers spring training game against the Kansas City Royals. Again, 3 o'clock Friday afternoon on News from the Center in Richland Center. The Milwaukee Bucks will be in Boston tonight to take on the Celtics. The broadcast starts at 6 tonight, and you can catch the game on Oshkosh Air Support, News from the Center, Lake Aaron Amory, WRJN in Racine, 98Q Country in Park Falls, and locally grown radio in Wisconsin Rapids. Again, the play-in games were, the first couple of play-in games were held last night for the NCAA tournament, filling in one of the 16 seeds and filling in one of the 10 seeds. I printed out a whole bunch of copies of the brackets. The brackets are going to be ready.
Those are insane. I got asked to join a bracket thing, and I was like, yeah sure, I'll do it. And then I'm just going to autofill. I'm just autofilling.
Well, I mean, you can guess just as easily as you can autofill. So, I mean, that's half the fun. Like, you know, when I say St. Mary's versus Grand Canyon, and we ask ourselves, where these schools are? Where is St. Mary's?
I feel like one of them is really self-explanatory.
Well, region, yes, but what if it's in Southern Nevada? We don't know. We don't know these things.
All right.
We're gonna learn things tomorrow morning, I think, about some of this.
All right.
Anyway, then come Friday, the main tournament kicks off Thursday and Friday, and both the Badgers and Marquette are in Friday games. Marquette will take on Western Kentucky at 1 o'clock Friday afternoon in Indianapolis, and the Badgers, a 5 seed, will play 12 seed James Madison Friday night, 8:40 p.m. in Brooklyn. If they win that game, they'll take on the winner of Duke versus Vermont. So, you know, it's a rough path forward for the Wisconsin Badgers, but they're going to give it a go. All right, our homeroom segment is coming up next. We're going to be talking about the Chippewa Falls School referendum and what it means for all of the 90-plus around the state of Wisconsin on April 2nd. Live from Lake Wasota, this is Up North News Radio on the Civic Media Radio Network. All right, we are back on a Wednesday, March 20th, 7:34 right now on Up North News Radio. Welcome to our weekly homeroom segment where we talk about education, public education, the challenges, the opportunities, the obstacles. The opportunities for schools will include the elections to be held on April 2nd all around the state, along with school board races, county board, town board, city council, what have you. There are going to be 91 different school referendum questions on the ballot. And that's not because 91 school districts suddenly decided to get, you know, a little spendy, shall we say. It's because there is a real issue with what the Wisconsin legislature has done for state aid that has not kept up with inflation, as you've heard over and over in this segment, for 16 years. So we talked last week about the biggest of those referendums, that in the Milwaukee School District. Now we wanted to get a feel for, you know, one of the other school districts around the state. And so to that end, we brought in Jeff Holmes, the superintendent for the Chippewa Falls School District, and business manager Chad Trowbridge. Gentlemen, good morning.
Good morning, Pat. Thanks for having
us. Good morning. Yeah. Nice good morning, Pat. Thank you for having us today.
Yeah, nice to have you both here. So let's start with just with Chippewa Falls before we talk any more about kind of a statewide overview here. But Jeff, how about if we start with you as you are kind of introducing the referendum to other people, because clearly not everybody knows, you know, that there's a referendum in their school district. How do you break the ice on that? What do you tell them is on the ballot?
Well, for us, it's a very simple question. It's a 3-year non-recurring referendum that allows for the district to obtain $2.5 million per year during that period of time. It would be for the 2024 through 2027 school years, at which time it would sunset. So very simply put, it just allows for us to maintain staffing levels, programs, and services and facilities to the degree that we need to based on the shortfall from the state. They didn't make up for their gap in inflation.
Well, and that's putting it mildly here, because again, people will say, "Well, wait, in the last state budget, there was this deal that increased funding." And again, we've talked quite a bit about how, yeah, it was an increase in dollars, but doesn't come close to making it up. Chad, by chance, would you know, is there if over this, whatever period, say the 16 years that it hasn't kept up with inflation, do you know what kind of a shortfall that's meant to just the Chippewa Falls School District?
Yeah, it's been about $3,300 per student over that period of time, which is very, very significant. If we were to have that $3,300 per pupil, in all likelihood, we wouldn't be faced with a question like this right now.
Exactly. And that's the point that I know the Wisconsin Public Education Network has been making as well. And it would be one thing if it were, say, during my time in the legislature, you know, during the Great Recession, when there was not only not a budget surplus, but, you know, we were working really hard to keep the budget balanced and not run a deficit. It's quite another matter when you've got a record budget surplus of upwards of $7 billion. Estimates have it closer to $3 billion now. But, Jeff, what for you and other superintendents and school officials, do you feel like that state surplus back when it was closer to $7 billion, do you feel they could have swung, that the legislature could have swung the extra $3,300 per pupil just to continue, you know, operations as they are without having to go to referendum?
Well, I do think there was an effort legislatively and gubernatorially in that regard. The problem was they didn't factor in the inflationary pieces to that. Had they made up for those inflationary increases, I think we as a school district probably, as Chad stated, wouldn't be in the position that we're in today. So I do know that there was a concerted effort, and we greatly appreciate that. But certainly in this upcoming next biennium budget process, they're going to have to do a better job of taking in consideration all factors. And it's not just inflation. We're seeing increases in the area of special ed. There needs to be help in that area as well. Mental health services, since they were placed on school districts, there needs to be help there also. So my big ask of the legislators and the governor is to look at the whole picture.
Yeah, I mean, I couldn't possibly put it any better. Though I will note again, as I do, that this is not just about pointing out the legislative shortfalls. Because if that were the case, you'd have voters saying, "Okay, well then I'm going to vote no to all of this because the whole system is bad." But what we're really looking for is support, local support for school districts. Yeah, the legislature has essentially passed the buck and forced school districts to ask property taxpayers to raise their own costs. But Chad, this particular referendum itself, can you talk about the cost per year per taxpayer if the referendum goes through? Because I'm not going to say it's not nothing, but you know, it is something that is probably worthwhile for a lot of voters to consider, you know, what that extra cost would be, that it's not going to break a lot of banks.
Yeah, we would never say it's not nothing, because anytime there's a tax increase, it's always something. But when we look at what property values are projected or have been growing and what they're projected to grow in the coming years, we're estimating that the impact of this referendum, $2.5 million each year for 3 years, would have an average impact of about 5 cents per thousand of property value. So if you consider that to be, you know, what an average home value might be within our district, we're estimating that to be around $12.50 a year.
So $12.50 a year is what you're asking for over a period of 3 years. And Jeff, why the period of 3 years? I know that there's notes that you could project a deficit as far as 5 years out. So people might say, well, why not have a 5-year referendum? Others might say, why don't you make it annual and come back to us, you know, year over year? So what is the basis for the 3-year request?
The 3 years for us was discussed was debated. I think that's the best way to put it. You know, for us, it boiled down to 3 years because of the opportunity for the state to fix the funding formula in relation to inflation and other facets of school funding that need to be addressed. So when we looked at our overall budget over the next 3 years, those were the three hardest years that we see over the next five. And also, people need to keep in mind that we're the 33rd largest school district in the state of Wisconsin. Yet in our per pupil spending, we rank 267th. So since 1993, Chippewa Falls Area Unified School District has been a district that's been frugal all along the way. We've gotten a lot out of our operations, even though we're not, I would consider Chippewa Falls Area Unified School District to be a frugal school district, and we've always operated that way. So for us, it boiled down to remaining being a frugal district. Doing it annually, we didn't think we would be able to put ourselves in a very secure position. By going out the 3 years, we have time to work with legislators and the governor and others to make them better understand that the way the current formula works is not in the best interest of schools. And we do believe that it's a state obligation to more fund schools than the local taxpayer. So well, that was our reason.
Certainly to be much more of a partner in all of this rather than continuing to denigrate and harm public education. Chad, and that was, by the way, that was Jeff Holmes, superintendent of Chippewa Falls Schools, and Chad Trowbridge is the business manager. And again, everything we're saying about Chippewa Falls, just lay that over the top of whatever school district you might be in if they have a referendum up, because a lot of these problems are very similar. And so, Chad, in a lot of these districts, as well as yours, I'm sure people are saying, wait a minute, weren't there all kinds of extra funds that were given in terms of pandemic relief? I'll put it the way some people might, what did you do with that money?
Well, it's a fantastic question, Pat, and I do think there is quite a bit of misinformation about that. The pandemic relief funding, referred to as ESSER funding, was intended to bolster education. In the state of Wisconsin, we did not get per pupil increases during the course of the pandemic. The message was loud and clear: use your federal COVID dollars. So I will add that this is something that really has contributed to this budget shortfall problem. As Jeff mentioned earlier, you know, we think the state did a reasonable job of trying to address some of the shortfalls in public schools, but when those per pupil increases were not given throughout the course of the pandemic, and then we have our federal ESSER funding that's going to expire the end of this fiscal year, that is truly those two combination of factors is what has led to this gap.
And as we mentioned at the top of the program, at this point, you know, going back to 1994, when this whole school, current school funding system was crafted with whatever good intentions were out there, the way that it's been handled ever since, if you go back to 1994, basically 80% of school districts, 80% at some point have had to go to voters in a referendum just for operational purposes, you know, in shorthand, to keep the lights on. But if this particular operational referendum, Jeff, does not pass, and again, I don't want to be accused of scare tactics here, but you have to come up with a plan. If the vote is no on this referendum, what would be the next steps that the Chippewa District would take?
Well, let's set the record straight, Pat. Right now, in the state of Wisconsin, 86% of school districts have had to go to operational referendums since the inception of revenue limits. So it's grown just since the last time you probably looked at those statistics. All right, for Chippewa Falls Area Unified School District, if we're put in a position to make cuts in this next year, not related to declining enrollment, we're looking at having to make $1.9 million in cuts. For us as a school district, I commend Mr. Trowbridge. He's been here for 21 years. Again, he's one of the main reasons over that period of time that we've been able to operate as well as we have been and still remain a frugal and conscientious, fiscally conscientious school district. But because of the efficiencies and operations that have taken place during the course of those years, we as a district are at a point where you're talking about having to reduce in programming and in people. That's the only two real places left to cut. And in the modern age, particularly in 2024, given everything that we know about school business, it is more about the people. You know, we're not developing products. We can't raise our prices to capture more revenue other than to ask our public to support it. It's one for me, given everything that's occurred in this district since 2014 and what we know from our constituents about what they want for their kids. If you start cutting programming and people, you're going to see a decline in your ability to offer the quality services you have over time.
And there's no other way to put that. Chad, just to wrap things up quick, any kind of a referendum is a reason for a community conversation. And as Jeff said, you've been with the school district for a long time here, a part of the community. How is that community conversation going? How are you feeling about the way that you've talked to people in the district who are going to be voting on this?
Well, we always appreciate the opportunity to be able to discuss this with any members of our community. And I would say for the most part, it's been pretty positive. Whenever you ask for a tax increase, that's never an easy pill to swallow for everyone. But I would say, generally people have understood why we're asking the question, whether they support it or not, ultimately is their decision when they step into the ballot box.
Exactly, which they'll be doing on April 2nd, but we really appreciate being able to give that perspective to voters in Chippewa Falls and elsewhere to look at the big picture of why this is the way that it is and to maybe think about November elections rather than the April 2nd ones if you have issues with how things are going. Jeff Holmes, Chippewa Falls Superintendent, Chad Trowbridge, Chippewa Falls Business Manager. Guys, thank you so much. I really appreciate it. Have a great day.
Thank you, Pat.
And we will be back with Todd Alba coming up next. You're up north. Yeah, we're playing Mr. Rogers again, mostly just to calm ourselves after a segment like this, like we just had, where we again talk about how the Wisconsin legislature has let us down for 12 years now. And the way to take out that frustration is in November, not in April. And Todd Alba joins us now, and he too, like Mr. Rogers, is tossing shoes around.
I was trying to find a really cool dance mix, but they all sucked.
There's a dance mix of the Mr. Rogers theme.
They weren't good. They weren't good at all. So,
oh my goodness, that's hilarious. Yeah. How are you, Mr. Alba?
We could all use a little Mr. Rogers in our life. As
always, always.
Oh, yes. Hang on. Just don't go anywhere. I can still talk to you. I'm moving around.
Oh, sure.
Oh, great.
Make yourself at
home.
Todd
Alba walks off the show.
Yep.
Nope, I'm coming back. Look what my sister gave me for Christmas.
Mr. Rogers figurine.
And if you want, I'm not sure if we'll pick this up, but listen to this.
I think we're supposed to hear the trolley.
Yeah. It has little quotes from Mr. Rogers. It says, "You have made this day a special day just by being you." See, that's what America
so
needs for Mr. Rogers.
And yet, when you tried to play it for us, you held it up to your ear rather than your microphone, which really
I have an ear pod in. That's one of my mics.
Okay.
Todd knows how to do stuff, Pat. Don't be mean.
Well,
sometimes. Yeah.
What's new? What's happening?
Well, we wanted to find out what's going to be new and happening on the Todd Alba Show here, especially as we spoke in our first hour about the many ways that former President Donald Trump continues to spin these lies. And I feel like we are duty bound to just not let those kinds of things slide. And I'm sure that, when it's whether it's Trigvi Olsen or other either former Republicans or non-Trump Republicans, hear all this, they get really bothered at hearing the same lies about Iran suddenly getting billions of dollars that went to Hamas to fund the attack in Israel because they're misconstruing, some assets that were frozen. He's continuing to lie about NATO countries somehow not paying their bills. And all I'm seeing here, and then there's the one about Israel where he's saying, well, if you're Jewish, you can't vote Democratic. And that's not Donald Trump's call to make. But in all of these cases, you know, if these things aren't debunked, they're only going to spread.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, we talked about it on Monday a little bit. You may have seen over the weekend, Trump was down at this campaign event in Dayton, Ohio. And of course, the bloodbath comments. And we played the entire thing on the show so nobody could say we took it out of context. And yes, he was talking about foreign trade, but he used this language. And Trigvi also, as you mentioned, from the Lincoln Project, like myself, a former Republican, he wrote a column, or what happened was good old Scotty Walker, our former governor, tweeted some nonsensical tweet supporting Trump. And Trigvi and I and Scott are all about the same age. And Trigvi just took him to task on Twitter, and it got picked up by Raw Story and became literally an international story. And to your point, Pat, what Trigvi is pointing out is that, look, it is this ongoing pattern of rhetoric. It fires people up. It divides us. And then he alone can fix it, in his words. And these are all hallmarks. If you add everything that you said and what I just said and what Trigvi said together, it is the hallmark of authoritarianism. And I think that people in Wisconsin, Western Wisconsin, rural Wisconsin, urban Wisconsin, that may have voted for Trump in, say, 2016, that may be voting for the local sheriff who is a Republican, I just think that these divisive, hateful comments, as you point out, lies, are not going to wash with the majority of voters in November. And so, yeah, I think it's incumbent upon us to point out factually where he's just blatantly wrong.
Well, and on top of that, I think the thing that still kind of confuses me is the way that people say, well, things were better off under Trump, when there's zero empirical evidence. You know, when Trump says, are you better off than 4 years ago? 4 years ago, we couldn't buy toilet paper. There right. wasn't any toilet paper on the shelves. Things weren't so great. He botched, you know, the handling of it. But that's the least of it. It's just that people know his record, or at least they should. And it's like you said, it's not 2016 where he's like, well, let's try a fresh approach with an outsider. He is so inside, he's never wanting to go outside of power again. He'll do what it takes to stay inside the corridors of power. And yet, Mr. Alba, and yet, despite Robin Voss yesterday attacking Trump supporters as whack jobs and morons for trying to recall him, he also said he does endorse Donald Trump for president this fall. You can't make this stuff up.
We used it on Monday, I think, in talking about the rally and these Republicans who are genuflecting at the altar of Trump. We used it Monday. I think we'll dial it up again. Really, the only response to that is, you know, Donald Trump has a message for all these Republicans like Robin Voss, and it's in a song, appropriately so, in a Mr. Rogers form. Only the song call is from Hamilton, and it's called "You'll Be Back, Wait and See." I mean, that's Donald Trump. He's just looking at these Republicans saying, "You'll be back. And if you don't, I'll send a battalion of army peoples to convince you." I mean, that is Donald Trump. And it's a campaign of fear. It's a campaign of anger and retribution. When he says these things, as Trigvi reminds us, as someone who's fought authoritarianism around the world, he means it. It's not campaign rhetoric. Believe them when they say that they're going to be a dictator on day one.
You almost wonder who has to be busier in the final weeks of the presidential campaign. Is it the Biden campaign, which will try to stay positive and talk about their achievements? Or I would argue the real responsibility is going to be on good American Republicans to say, I'm not with this guy. You know, and I'm not even going third party, that voting for Biden is the only way that this is going to get done right.
You're absolutely right. If the people in the middle, really, and I know people don't like centrists or moderates, those words, but let's describe them, right? Trigvi talks about, you know, Dobbs dads, men, white men predominantly, who might traditionally vote conservative, but have a daughter, a wife, a woman in their life. And they're like, look, I want healthcare accessible to them. And I'm going to vote for Joe Biden because of that. It's a quote unquote traditional principled conservative Republican who says Trump is a step too far. But also on the other side, it's also progressive Democrats who say, look, Joe Biden might not necessarily do it for me, but now is not the time to vote Jill Stein or third party. And to this point that we made in our show before, I don't think that people like us can look down on people who are voting for looking at third party. We have to encourage them and convince them that Joe Biden is the positive choice for democracy and for a path forward. No matter which side of the aisle we're on, if we don't have democracy moving forward and freedom, none of these other lesser arguments on policy are going to matter.
The conversation continues with Todd Alba, noon to two today across Civic Media. Thank you, sir. Talk to you a little later on.
Your Girl Scout cookies.
I will bring them along. Count on it. All right. Greg, thank you as well. Thank you all for listening. Up North News is the Wisconsin outlet for Courier, a pro-democracy news outlet that's building a more informed, engaged, and representative America. You can get our newsletter by signing up at upnorthnewswi.com. Follow me on social media. Be back here tomorrow at 6.